Greetings, masterclass and practical class members. I'm thrilled to unveil my knee joint injection protocol, the Combo Plus protocol, tailor-made for addressing severe chronic medial knee pain. Several physicians have expressed curiosity regarding my frequency of using the Combo Plus protocol and my strategies for patient management post-acute severe pain relief. In response, I'm supplementing this with a medical chart that outlines the patient's treatment journey, protocols, intervals, medications used, and the eventual transition to other alternatives. It becomes the medial knee RPT treatment, interfascial injection with the whole blood. This is because osteoarthritic pain, while not curable, can be managed up to the point of interventions like total knee replacement or even beyond. For those following my YouTube channel, the P1 solution and its mixing procedure with Botox should be familiar territory. For details on the quantities and target sites, I delve into it extensively there. I highly recommend viewing the Adult Knee Intervention series, a comprehensive 15-video sequence if you're unfamiliar. Now, let's delve into the patient's profile and history. A 71-year-old female presented with persistent right knee pain lasting for 2 years. The pain was exacerbated during walking and was particularly pronounced when descending stairs. She reported a clicking sound during movement. She had previously sought treatment from a local pain clinic, receiving a series of injection treatments. Altogether, she underwent injections on 10 separate occasions until 1 week ago. The patient shared that she had been receiving Prolia injections every 3 months as a treatment for osteoporosis. Prolia, a monoclonal antibody, is used as an anti-osteoporotic agent. Upon physical examination, she showed pain during passive extension. An X-ray of the knee indicated minimal degenerative change, less than grade 2 kL degenerative change, with mild loss of the medial joint space. An ultrasound revealed the medial meniscus bulging out, which I categorized as a level 3 bulge based on my ultrasound classification system. Mild suprapatellar bursal effusion was observed, and focal fluid distension was noted in the posterior fossa beneath the posterior capsule. Given her medical history and the persistent pain, I recommended an MRI for a more comprehensive assessment. The MRI results depicted a pronounced bone marrow edema in the anterior and medial subchondral bone of the tibia. Diffuse loss of the hyaline cartilage in the medial femoral condyle accompanied by minimal subchondral bone lesions. A horizontal degenerative change in the posterior horn of the medial meniscus, along with grade 2 degeneration and a focal tear in the posterior root of the medial meniscus. Mild fluid in the suprapatellar bursa and localized fluid accumulation in the posterior fossa. Based on the MRI and ultrasound findings, along with the physical examination, I concluded that the pain's primary origins were the subchondral bone marrow lesion in the anterior and middle segments of the medial tibial condyle, degenerative changes in the posterior horn of the medial meniscus combined with a posterior root tear, a mild, protective, reactive bony spur on the medial side of the knee. I proposed the medial knee combo plus injection protocol for acute pain relief in response to these findings. This regimen encompasses a medial interfascial injection containing 30 U of Botox mixed with 0.5 mL of dexamethasone palmitate. 2 blocks on the upper and lower branches of the medial genicula, each containing 0.5 mL of dexamethasone palmitate and 4 mL of bupivacaine. An injection into the posterior fossa with 1 mL of dexamethasone palmitate and 30 U of Botox. The selection of injection targets is underpinned by specific therapeutic purposes tailored to address pain sources and ensure effective relief. Posterior fossa injection, this is designed to block the sensory nerves of the posterior root and the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. The technique facilitates the direct spread of water-soluble steroids into these structures, targeting localized inflammation within the posterior fossa. Medial knee interfascial injection, this injection's primary target is the medial meniscus's medial horn, aiming to provide relief in that localized region. Medial superior and inferior genicular nerve block, These nerves cater to the sensation of the anterior and middle sections of the tibial and femoral articular surfaces. Blocking these nerves effectively alleviates pain stemming from these articulatory zones. Follow-up treatment and results. Injection therapy and interval. After the initial treatment, the patient underwent the combo plus protocol, which showed good results. Following the success of the first treatment, the patient received another round of the combo plus protocol with a 2-week interval. The outcome remained positive. Another combo plus protocol session was administered after another 2-week interval, resulting in satisfactory outcomes. Subsequently, the treatment shifted to whole blood injections targeting the medial interfascial layer. This serial whole blood injection was performed at 1-month intervals, totaling 5 sessions over 5 months. The primary objective of the whole blood injection is to fortify the structural integrity of the medial joint capsule and medial collateral ligament. This integrity has been compromised due to the constraint from tears in the posterior root and horn of the medial meniscus, resulting in bulging. Essentially, there are 2 pivotal strategies to reinforce the medial compartment. The first is the surgical anchoring of the posterior root of the medial meniscus. However, many surgeons are hesitant about this method, primarily because of concerns regarding the patient's age and the existing degeneration in the meniscus body. This perspective often leads to a wait-and-see approach, allowing the condition to progress to stage 4 degeneration. At this point, total knee arthroplasty becomes a viable option. The alternative approach is to thicken the medial joint capsule. Increasing the volume and strength of the medial thigh muscles allows the capsule to be tightened, thus enhancing the knee's stability. To supplement this, I recommended a minimal intake of NSAIDs to the patient, aiming to offer her better pain relief. Furthermore, I encouraged her to adopt a proactive coping strategy, such as home cycling exercises, which would not only help manage pain but also work towards increasing the volume of the thigh muscles. Current state. The patient reports a good and satisfactory condition, indicating the effectiveness of the combined treatment approach. Thank you for watching. This will assist you in choosing the appropriate protocol and managing follow-up care effectively. See you in the next session.